And it's really a contrast of what is important when you are young compared to, well, when you are old compared to when you are young. When you're young, you have certain views of everything. You see things a certain way, and you you are affected maybe more on a surface level, certainly on a surface level. On an experiential level, what we're experiencing in the earth, therefore, much of the experience of it obviously is temporal. That's going to end as soon as the experience is over with. But it's not just that. There is, when you're younger, and we're not just talking in age-wise, we're talking about spiritually also, there is perceptions that will change. And things that seem so important will not seem so important after a while. And as you mature in the Lord, it changes how you see things. Now that makes sense, because really our spiritual growth is all about seeing. It's all about seeing Him. It's all about knowing Him on a deeper level. And that contrast of the definition of spirituality compared to what we used to call this is really spiritual. And I want to do that. I want to do that contrasting Paul's experience when he met the Lord compared to how he describes that many years later, the very same experience. The very same event, let me put it like that, how he describes the very same event. One, pretty much right after he got saved, and what he saw, and what he experienced. And the other one, after years of walking with the Lord, and he takes that experience, that same experience, and it's defined in a completely different way. I mean, it is just incredible. In fact, there's only one primary thing that was left in his older age of seeing things that he kept, that was from the youth. And that was that he persecuted the church. That's the only thing he kept from it. And everything else is described completely different. But before we do that, I want to just look at a couple of scriptures. If you would, turn with me to 1 Corinthians chapter 2, and we'll do verse 9 and 10. First Corinthians 2, verse 9. But as it is written, eye hath not seen, nor ear heard, neither have entered into the heart of man the things which God hath prepared for them that love him. Verse 10, but God hath revealed them unto us by his Spirit, for the Spirit searcheth all things, yea, the deep things of God. All right, this statement is written, we haven't got to the contrast yet. We haven't got to the scripture. What we're going to do is we're going to contrast Acts chapter 9 and Paul's explanation of his conversion. Not yet, but we're going to go over a few other scriptures. But we're going to compare and contrast Acts chapter 9 with Galatians chapter 1. But before we do that, these are some more mature views that he has come to. And it begins with, but as it is written, I have not seen. Now, folks, come on. Admit that there is a bunch that we have read that was written in the scriptures that we have not yet experienced in maturity. Because he says, as it is written, yes, it's written there, but as long as it's just written there, not written on our fleshly tables of our heart, it's just, you know, you can memorize scripture and not have it written on the fleshly tables of your heart, right? The Pharisees did it. Modern day Pharisees do it. That could include some of you here. he is trying to take this out of the as it is written, and he's trying to say, eye hath not seen, ear hath not heard, neither hath entered into the heart of man certain things just because you're saved. Okay? But then he starts talking about how that comes about. Verse 10, but God hath revealed them unto us. And so it is a process of revelation. It's a process of the Spirit of God taking... Okay, so let's talk about that just for a second. It's a process of revelation. It's a process of the Spirit of God taking what? What are we going to say? What are we going to say? Taking the Scriptures and revealing, taking deep things? Yes and no. Taking the deep things of the heart of God, the deep things of His heart. Not just the surface thing. Does he heal? Yes. Will he heal even sinners? Yes. I mean, but the deal is that there is this place where you begin to come to where your interest doesn't lie in eye seeing or ear hearing. It starts coming to that place of wanting to know the deep things of the heart of God. It's not about seeing. See, I think even quote unquote the deeper life movement can be just about seeing and hearing something from God. And that's what I want. I want to hear something from God. I want to see something from God. I want to get into the Scriptures and I want to see, you know, something from God, not the deep things of God. Big difference. Big difference. One is a pursuit of the Lord and of the things that are important to him that he would call important. And the other one is a lot of times the pursuit of the Lord and for the things that we think are important. Even if they're deep religious things. Let me tell you, there is no deep thing that's more important than the Lord. And there's no deep thing that's more important than the deep things that are of or out of the heart of the Lord. So there's a honing, there's a tuning, a finer tuning that starts happening in us when we mature, and the word mature really relates more not to getting older or having gray hair or you know, but rather to not be all self-focused in our searching and it be all about us. It doesn't have to affect our life to see the things that are in the heart of the Lord. And what I mean by that is our existence in the earth. You see what I'm saying? It doesn't have to affect. We don't have to get anything out of it. Except the joy that we sat at his feet and said, what's going on in your heart? And he shared with us. And we were seeking the good pleasure of his will, not for him to do some event every time we get around the Lord. You know, and you see that in the, you know, in the Gospels, they're always chasing after Jesus. Oh, heal me, you know, pulling on him, do this, do that. Just a constant wrong relationship. But then you have that crowd, and you know, and I share on it a lot, that crowd pressing. That's the word that it uses, pressing together, trying to get to Jesus. And they're all touching him, and they're all Jesus, you know, and he's just right there. I mean, it's not just walking with him like sheep following a shepherd. They're all on top of him and, you know, doing all of this stuff. And he's going on there for a while, and he's not saying anything. He's not saying a word. He's not saying, look, could we just, you know, he doesn't do that. He doesn't do that. He just keeps on going, and they're all pushing and touching and bumping and all this kind of stuff. And all of a sudden, there's a touch, and he stops the whole thing. And he says, who touched me? And Peter says, everybody. everybody's touching you. And he said, no, no, I mean, who really touched me? Who really reached me? That I felt something different here. Does it matter to the Lord? Yes, it does. My God, it does. We think, well, you know, just being one of those who are close to the Lord, and everybody's fighting to get closer, which means they're usually pushing somebody else out of the way, right? And this little old lady, she's got an issue of blood. I don't know how she got in there, you know, except she said, if I just touch, not even him, not even touching his body or what, but the hem of his garment, I'll be changed. And remember, it says, and virtue went out of him into her. Something that was in him went into her. That's it. That's the right touch. That's the one we want. Whatever's in him to come into us. And we can be Christians forever and never have any of that. But you see, it just doesn't happen. It just doesn't happen. It happens when our hearts begin to seek the deep things of God, not the deep things that are spiritual and da 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 da, but what are the things that are deeply in his heart. And we say, Lord, you know, I'm tired of everything being about me. I'm tired of it. I'm tired of it. I want to start something different. Well, so the next scripture I was going to talk about is 2 Corinthians 3:16. All of us are familiar with these scriptures. Or I guess we're going to do 16 through 18. Hallelujah. It's talking about the heart here in verse 15, and he says, but verse 16 says, nevertheless, when it, the heart, shall turn to the Lord. All right, now let's be honest. Let's just all be honest here for a minute. How many times do we think that we have deemed that our heart has turned to the Lord when it actually hadn't? You know? I know this is it. This is finally it. My heart is, I think we all are. I think we're all in that boat. It's like the disciples being in the boat freaking out, you know, and Jesus was either asleep or walking on the water. And they're going, you know. I mean, I don't want to get off on that, but that there's a beautiful reality that he's asleep in the boat because, and this is just an area I probably shouldn't even be even slightly addressing it because the Holy Spirit is speaking to me in incredible ways right now. But Jesus didn't feel the need to wake up and get up and stop that. But we did. The disciples did. We feel the need that he needs to get up and get involved in our storm. And I'm not going to try to explain why he doesn't feel that need. But it's an amazing reality. So this, nevertheless, when the heart shall turn to the Lord, the veil shall be taken away. Now the Lord is that Spirit, and where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is liberty. But we all, with open face, beholding as in a glass, a mirror, the glory of the Lord, are changed into the same image from glory to glory, even as by the Spirit of the Lord. All right, so there is this heart turning, and this is what we're going to see with Paul. There's a heart turning at a certain juncture. And let's talk about love. Can you just automatically, you know, for example, the Lord says, love one another, you know. Or what if your parent says, you know, you're their daughter, and they say, fall in love with that guy, I like him. How's that work? You know, yeah, just go fall in love with him, okay? You go, oh, okay. Ah, you know, It just doesn't work that way. I mean, it has to be something of the heart. Okay? And so we're trying to make all this stuff with the Lord, we're trying to make it head knowledge or commitment level of ministry or everything that has to do with down here. We don't know how to live with him where he is. And Jesus said, where are you going? He says, well, don't worry, where I go, you will be also. You will be, you will not do. This is the thing of being and being, you know. And that, Paul is the one who said that. In him we live, and in him we move, and in him we have our being. And that is union with. I wanted to say the supreme being, but that's. I mean, it still misses the mark by far. It really does. It really does. Thank you, Lord. But there's this heart turning. There's this heart turning. What if the heart turning had nothing to do with a desire to take away the veil? Should I say it again? What if the heart turning here had nothing to do in the person who's turning, had nothing to do with taking away a veil? What if it had to do with just wanting to know the deep things of his heart? And the veil is just taken away because that's an automatic of it. Like flipping a switch. We call it turn on the light, but actually we're flipping a switch. But when you flip that switch, the light comes on. So we're running around in the darkness trying to go, well, if I throw this cup in the air, will it turn on the light? If I push this over, if I work hard, if I mop the floor like, yeah, you know, like a sailor or something, you know, is that going to make a difference? No, it's not. You want to flip the switch? Your heart has to go after him for him. Is that okay? Should I stop? Well, this is what Paul is trying to communicate to us. Now, the Lord is that Spirit. What is that talking about? And where the Spirit of the Lord is, there's liberty. He's talking about everything in that chapter up to that point. He's talking about the letter and the Spirit, the letter and the Spirit. As it is written, so just read it and try to keep it. No. No, because it's written, your eyes haven't seen. But we're still trying to read it and keep it. And the Lord is that Spirit. That's the Spirit of the thing that we need. And when we see him, the Lord is that Spirit. When we see him, we're changed into that same Spirit, that same image, that Jesus, that life and that nature. And that does not come by anything but a heart saying, I don't care if the veil is, I don't even want to think about it. I don't even want to know there is a veil. I just want to know there's a heart. You know? I just want to know the heart. But we're can I say it? We're still impure. We are. We're still mixed. We have things in us, and they're hard things to get rid of. They're not like laying in our heart. They're like leeches and parasites that are within us, that are sucking the life out of us, that only the cross and only the Spirit of God can reveal, and only in the light of his face. Then you're changed. Then the leeches fall off. Then. So what is that? What is that? It's a pure thing. It's as pure. The pure in heart will see God. It's pure. I want you. See, the pure in heart want to see God. What are you pure in heart? If the Lord would say, that man is pure in heart. So we run to him and say, well, what, you know, so are you pure in heart? And he would go, no. You know what I'm saying? He would say no and say, well, the Lord said that you're pure in heart. How did you get pure in heart? Did you stop this? And did you, you know, quit that? And did you take on that? And did you do this and that and that? And he goes, I don't know what the Lord's talking about. I just want Jesus. And the Lord goes, see? See? There it is. There it is. It's not sinless perfection. He could care less about sinless perfection. If he was after that, he'd just stick with the angels and forget us. Right? He'd just say, well, you know what? These guys were before y'all. I'm sticking with the angels. They never sin. Except that bunch with Lucifer. But anyway, never mind. But if the issue was sin in his mind, now you know that he died for all sin, right? He doesn't have to die every time somebody sins again, right? Okay. So the churches in general, all over the United States, all over the world, is there sin within the churches? Yeah, there is. Is there a fair amount of sin? Couldn't you maybe even say there's a lot of sin? Okay. Why doesn't he just destroy us all then? Because he's not going, there's sin, oh, there's sin, there's sin, there's sin, there's sin, there's sin. He's going, look, I know what I did, and this is going to be okay. My concern, the Lord would say, is that our hearts, I almost got off there for a second. I felt that. Anyway, in my heart, is that our hearts get off of us, get off of this world, and mature, but let's not call it maturity. We could even say we're backslidden, but I want Jesus, and you're better off than the Pharisees. Remember the stories and the parables and all this stuff? Come on. I mean, there's enough there to wake us up, but we just read right over and go, that's good. What does it mean? I don't know. Do you apply it? No. I'm not even sure what to apply. I'm just a Christian. I'm just saved. He wants more than that. He wants more than that. And you know, he could have saved us and made us, put it in our heart where we would faithfully follow him without fail. But instead, he gave us free will. And he gave us a heart that could turn to him and that could allow him in to such a degree that you're no longer two, but one. See, he did do that. And now he says, I would like it to be real in you. You know, we would say, it's real in Jesus. Jesus is the real thing. It's real. Yes. And then he goes, well, you know, why don't you try that yourself toward me? You know, let's have a little realness here. All right, so let's look at Ephesians 3. Ephesians 3, verse 3 and 4. How that by revelation he made known unto me the mystery, as I wrote afore in few words, whereby when you read, you may understand my knowledge in the mystery of Christ. The mystery of Christ. The mystery of Christ. All right. Well, the word Christ means Messiah, folks, and the Messiah was seen it at the cross, at self-giving to gain us. There's your Messiah. There's your Messiah. Paul said, I'm determined not to know anything among you except Messiah crucified. I mean, after, you know, Jesus, you know, made the church and Paul came along, The Messiah was never again understood as just the Jewish guy that was going to save them from the Romans and this and that and that. I want you to think of this. From then on, all of the church understood the Messiah as Messiah crucified. From then on, they still believed in the Messiah, just Messiah crucified, not in the same manner that they did. Paul said, I want you to understand my knowledge in the mystery of Christ. And then, of course, in Colossians 1:27, to whom God would make known what is the riches of the glory of this mystery among the Gentiles, which is Christ in you, the hope of glory. There is the necessity how that by revelation he made known unto me the mystery. You can be saved on the road to Damascus and not know the mystery yet. Amen? All right, so let's get into our main thing. Let's go to Acts chapter 9. I think when we get ready to contrast this, I think it would be best if you knew the whole story. So I'm going to go ahead and read Acts 9, 1 through 18. A little bit of reading, but you can either follow along or just listen however you want to do it. But I want you to try to listen to the particulars. What did I say? Listen to the particulars. Listen to the articulars as I say it. Okay, verse 1, Acts 9. And Saul, yet breathing out threatenings and slaughter, wow, this guy's of God, against the disciples of the Lord, went unto the high priest and desired of him letters to Damascus, to the synagogues, that if he found any of this way, whether they be men or women, he might bring them bound unto Jerusalem. And as he journeyed, he came near Damascus, and suddenly there shined round about him a light from heaven. And he fell to the earth and heard a voice saying unto him, Saul, Saul, why persecutest thou me? And he said, Who art thou, Lord? And the Lord said, I am Jesus whom thou persecutest. It is hard for thee to kick against the pricks. And he, trembling and astonished, said, Lord, what wilt thou have me to do? And the Lord said unto him, Arise and go into the city, and it shall be told thee what thou must do. And the men which journeyed with him stood speechless, hearing a voice, but seeing no man, which meant that Paul saw the Lord. They only heard it. And Saul arose from the earth, and when his eyes were opened, he saw no man. But they led him by the hand and brought him into Damascus. And he was 3 days without sight, and neither did eat nor drink. And there was a certain disciple at Damascus named Ananias. And to him said the Lord in a vision, Ananias. And he said, Behold, I am here, Lord. And the Lord said unto him, Arise and go into the street which is called Straight, and inquire in the house of Judas of one called Saul of Tarsus. For behold, he prayeth and hath seen in a vision a man named Ananias coming in and putting his hand on him that he might receive his sight. Then Ananias answered, Lord, I have heard by many of this man how much evil he hath done to thy saints at Jerusalem. And here he hath authority from the chief priest to bind all that call on thy name. But the Lord said unto him, Go thy way, for he is a chosen vessel unto me, to bear my name before the Gentiles and kings and the children of Israel. For I will show him how many great things he must suffer for my name's sake. And Ananias went his way and entered into the house, and putting his hands on him, said, Brother Saul, the Lord, even Jesus, that appeared unto thee in the way as thou camest, hath sent me that thou mightest receive thy sight and be filled with the Holy Ghost. And immediately there fell from his eyes, as it were, as it had been scales, and he received sight forthwith and arose and was baptized. All right, so what this is the salvation experience. This is Paul telling this story. And this is early on. This is Acts chapter 9. This is him telling the story. And this is his explanation of what happened to him when he met the Lord. And it is that experience as he sees it, as he sees it at that time and at that point. So we're just going to go down the verses. We're just going to look at some of these things. And I want you to consider, as we do, what was your experience when you saw the Lord, when you met the Lord, okay? Was it anything like this? All right? Verse 3, saw a bright light from heaven. How many of you, when you first got saved, saw a bright light? No, not too many. Okay. Well, that puts him one up on you already. We're keeping score. We're keeping score here. Verse 4, he heard Jesus' voice. How many of you literally heard a voice when you got saved? I know some of you have since then, when you got saved. There you go. Verse 5, Paul asks, who are you? Now, that's a good question. How many of you, when you got saved, said, Lord, who are you? Or did we say, you're the Savior. You're the one that everybody, you know, told me that I could receive and be saved. Good question to start with, because that opens it wide, doesn't it? Verse 6. Jesus gives verbal directions. This is at salvation. Look, I want you, you know, he's the GPS. God's the GPS. And so go down this street, take a left, go down here, find the street straight, and, you know, there, go down a little way, and there's going to be this guy's house. Lord ever do that at your salvation, where he's literally, you know, it's like a GPS? Verse 7, others there had no such experience, meaning they heard a voice. It doesn't say they understood it either. They heard a voice, but they didn't see the Lord. Okay? Verse 8, he was made blind. All right. Now, most of us, you know, I think of John chapter 9, where there was the blind man there, and he met Jesus, and Jesus made him where he wasn't blind. But Jesus makes Saul of Tarsus, Paul, he makes him blind so that the last thing that he saw was Jesus' face. And it was so bright that he can't remember everything else. So that you have 3 days to think about this. Pretty good, huh? verse 9, he went 3 days without food and water. One more and he's dead. Because you can only go 3 days without water. That's a pretty big deal. That's his reaction to this. So far, I'm not done yet, but so far, these are the things that he's bringing up. He's the one who told this story here from which I'm drawing this out. This is his experience. This is his understanding of the Lord. This is his relationship with the Lord. This is what he knows of the Lord. Verses 10 through 12, God spoke to another man about Paul. God spoke to Ananias. And then God spoke to Paul and said, a guy named Ananias is going to come to you and pray for you. Don't kill him. Verse 13 and 14, though it was dangerous, the man obeyed and he came. Remember when Jesus appeared first, he said, Saul, Saul, why persecutest thou me? And Saul could have easily said, I am not persecuting you. I don't even know you. I have never met you. There has not, you know, we've never had contact before. So what's Jesus talking about? His body. He's persecuting him, his body. And so here, he doesn't just do this miraculously all at once or later. He sends a member of his body. He didn't have to do it that way, did he? But we're all one. We're one. So I don't feel like we're one. Well, you know, I'm hoping that you'll stop going by feelings one day. I mean, honestly, we need to get to the place where we quit using our mouth to go contrary to what God says and making that the word of God, but we're the God. Because we're the ones saying it, and that's our word, and we're the God that says this is it. We need to quit using our mouth to say things contrary to what Jesus has said is true of us. And you're not going to do, you know, there's two ways to do that. One way is, bless God, this is the word of God, and I believe every word in this book. I believe everything from Genesis to the maps. And I'm going to stand on the word. And even when we say that, we're almost talking about the book. And that's fine. I don't have a problem with that. I used to do that, and it was really good. It really helped me to stop thinking. But the other part is you are still susceptible to doubt because you're just making a stand on the word instead of having found his heart and seeing what is true of you in him. Because you're still you trying to make a stand on the word. But when you look into his heart, and you see, he's not, you know, who is he that condemneth? Shall Jesus who died for you so that you'd be one with him, does he condemn? No. Yeah. And it just, whew, it invigorates you on the inside. It brings light and life and freedom because you know this is his heart. That's his heart. And you can fight your heart or your mouth. Because if you just want to be an independent agent yourself, then you're on your own. You can fight all you want, but you're going to succumb to doubt eventually. But if you are one with him and you believe that and you see that and then you understand why he went into what he did and all the death that he went into, why he did that, which was to bring us into oneness with him, then you don't have any doubt because there's your proof right there, Jesus. See, that's your proof. Verse 15 called him a chosen vessel. He's a chosen vessel. Yeah. How many of you want to be a chosen vessel? Raise your hands. Well, wow, I never seen so few hands in my life. Well, it was chosen because to see how many things he's going to suffer, right? That's the next verse. You know, he's a chosen vessel. I will show him how many things he must suffer. Look at that. For I will show him how many great things. I love this. Great things. I love this. Lord, show me the great things you're going to use me for as your earthen vessel. As your chosen vessel, sorry. As your chosen vessel, show me the great things. And he goes, okay. And, you know, great things I'm going to suffer? Well, you know, I've often told the Lord, Lord, if I knew what all I was going through and you showed it to me at the beginning, I would have run. I would have. I would have just said, this is crazy. I mean, I would have. I would have said, you know what? I think I can find my own way. But you see, he doesn't do that, and here's the main reason why he doesn't do that, because all of the things that I got into that I ended up suffering over were things that I was with him, and in many cases, they really weren't even my sufferings. They were the sufferings of Christ, and I was privileged to be with him in that. You know, it would be like, I don't know, I'm just trying to make up something. It'd be like someone that you really, really, really love, and they come down with, you know, let's just say a guy and a girl, and, you know, you really, really love each other and stuff like that, and he comes down with leprosy, and the doctor says, you can't ever go in that room again. And she goes, but I love him. I, we're one. We're meant to be together. Well, you can't go in there. What do you mean I can't? Well, you can't, because if you do, it's going to be terrible. She walks right in the door. She's going, the door opens, no lock. What do you mean I can't? I can. I can do this if I want. You're getting why I'm making a big deal out of this? I can do this if I want. Goes in there, throws her arm around him because he hasn't had a hug or hadn't had, you know, any kind of love or attention on that level at all, and says, I will sit here with you, and I will feed you, and I will da-da-da-da. Going through all that kind of stuff, and somebody goes, you know, the parents come, get out of there, get out of there, run. And she goes, I'm staying right here. We'll drag you out. No, I won't be drug out, and if you do drag me out, I'll be right back in here. Why would you do this? You have such a future. You're young. You have all of this stuff before you. Because I love. See, suffering, when we talk about it, comes from a different place. It comes from free will in most cases. It comes from a desire to be with the Lord, so that we fellowship with him where he's suffering. I mean, I could go into that story more and more, but there's a beauty there, isn't there? There's a beauty there that Paul experienced. And you never hear Paul going, you know, anywhere in the New Testament, this is just too hard. Because he was always with the Lord in those things. You know what I'm saying? I mean, they're hard. But it's not too hard if you're with the Lord. It's too hard if you're not with the Lord. It's too hard if you're alone. It's too hard if you've got leprosy, you're shut away in a room, and people that tend to you don't care and don't want to be around you very long. Then that's hard. You know, and you talk about Paul or Watchman Nee, thrown in, you know, The communists in China come into his house, they grab him, they take him, and they throw him in prison. His wife is screaming, wanting him, and all this kind of stuff. And they put him in prison, and they won't let her come visit hardly at all. And he's there for 20 years till he dies. And you go, this is nightmarish. And he's just with the Lord. Like Paul's with the Lord, just with the Lord. I'm just with the Lord. Look, I'm just with the Lord. I can be with him here, or I can be without him out there witnessing on the streets. I can just be with him. But if that, see, the, no, but what are we talking about here? We're talking about things of the heart, aren't we? Again. Randy, what is your deal? We're talking about things of the heart. Because that's the way to reach him. We're always trying to find the way he can reach us. You know, I want to make myself more available. I want him to be able I want him to be able to touch my heart. And here's what we say. I want him to be able to touch my heart so that I can love him more. Is that hurtful? No, think about it. You know, here's a wife and here's the husband, and she goes, well, I want you to be able to do something so I can love you more. He's going, I want you to just think about it. He's going, really? So I have to do it in you, that something that's just not in your heart. And Christians pray that way all the time, you know. And that would hurt a husband or a wife. That would hurt, you know, that would a wife saying, you know, could you, you know, you know, just pray that I, you know, will love you more. If it's not in you, it's not in you. You know? But that would hurt us, but we don't think how our prayers sound to him. You know? All right. So, verse 17 and 18, he was physically and miraculously healed, made to see. All right, so what we're seeing here is one of the best testimonies you'll ever get. Amen? I mean, it is jam-packed with great stuff. And this is the way that Paul sees it. And these are the things that he's pointing out as he's looking in the scripture. This is what he's pointing out. And he's pointing out at this stage, he's pointing these things out and saying, this is important. But he's going to change. He's going to change down the road, okay? So there's this growth process that has to take place. And that things that seemed important at the beginning, they become, I like this word, they become overshadowed. That means something is growing and overshadowing what was there before. And they become, they affect our perspective of how we started, how we now begin to see things. And of course, that perspective is, once it was all about us, and now it's about him. And I want to say this too, the words don't change, but the meanings change. For example, he's going to use the word gospel, he's going to use the word grace of God, okay? But they're going to have a completely different meaning. What I wanted to do was, and I just didn't have time, but what I wanted to do was make a little cartoon figure of a person that looks kind of young, and they would have sort of young clothes. It would be a almost a stick figure, but the larger version, thicker body. Throw it up there and then show that, and then lay over it a completely different looking person after they'd matured in the Lord. So let's lay that template over the top of this now. Let's go to Galatians chapter 1. Galatians 1, and we're going to look at verse 6 through 9. Now, I want you to know, is he is on the verge here, right after this, starting in verse 12 anyway, he's going to start relating that story again. Okay, it's the same event, but it's going to sound completely different. But I want you to notice that right off the bat, he's using the word gospel. And he's defending the gospel, but he's not gonna do it. It's not gonna be the same thing. It's not gonna be the salvation experience that he had on the road to Damascus. It's gonna be something else. So pay attention, because it flows from one thing right to the next one. Okay, verse 6. I marvel that you are so soon removed from him that called you into the grace of Christ unto another gospel, which is not another, but there be some that trouble you and would pervert the gospel. So basically, his beef right now is a perversion of the gospel. So we would say, well, I received the gospel on the road to Damascus, and describe that event that he described in the book of Acts. But though we or an angel from heaven preach any other gospel unto you than that which we preached unto you, let him be accursed, as we said before, so say I now, if any man preach any other gospel unto you than that which you have received, let him be accursed. Okay, so we would read this and say, yeah, if anybody says that the blood of don't mention the blood of Jesus, well, the gospel is required to be in the gospel. He's not going to talk about the blood of Jesus. He's not going to talk about all the things that we would defend as the gospel. He's going to present it on a completely different level, just as he does the grace of God. So you notice The problem he has is with the gospel, or how it's being perverted. It's not being rightly understood, therefore it is being perverted. And so he's going to begin to describe it in terms of not his experience, but in terms of the revelation of that as God saw it. Okay? Galatians 1:12. For I neither received it, talking about the gospel, of man, neither was I taught it, but by the revelation of Jesus Christ. For ye have heard of my conversation in time past in the Jews' religion, how that beyond measure I persecuted the church of God and wasted it. So that's what he mentioned that, remember? He mentioned that in Acts 9. That's the only thing left over. Everything else is going to be changed. And wasted it. And verse 14, and profited in the Jews' religion above many mine equals in mine own nation, being more exceedingly zealous of the traditions of my fathers. And when it pleased God, verse 15, but when it pleased God, who separated me from my mother's womb and called me by his grace to reveal his son in me, that I might preach him among the heathen, immediately I conferred not with flesh and blood. All right, so first of all, he's talking about I neither received it by man, but by the revelation of Christ. What is he talking about? Is he talking about seeing Jesus on the road to Damascus? No. No, he's going to tell you what it is. In fact, we just read it, actually. To reveal his son in me. That's the revelation he's talking about. Did that happen on the road to Damascus? No. Jesus was over there. He was standing here. But in reality, there was a great work that was done and is being done to bring him to the reality of what really happened instead of an experience. Okay, so is he talking about it being revealed as Savior? Doesn't mention Savior here. He mentions Christ in him. And he's going to get into all that. So at first he was recalling his experience. Now he is communicating God's heart and the way God saw what happened to him. That's different. in verse 16, there is that change, that new definition of the word grace. So let's look at verse 15. But when it pleased God who separated me from my mother's womb and called me by his grace, comma, to reveal his son in me. There's not that, even though there's two different verses, it's one sentence. So listen to this. And call me by his grace to reveal his son in me. Call me by, he didn't say call me by his grace to save me from hell. He didn't say call me by his grace to make me happy in the earth as a Christian. He said the grace that I was talking about just a few verses up, I'm still talking about it. And that is the grace of God to reveal Christ in us. That's what the grace is there for. That's what he wants to bring about. the verse goes on. He called me by his grace to reveal his son in me, not to reveal the Savior to me, that I might preach him to the nations, to the heathen. All right, what is that saying? It's not saying, that's not talking about world evangelization in the sense that we see it. That's how we see it. But it's part of one long sentence. He called me by his grace so I might preach him to the heathen. No, he called me by his grace to reveal his son in me. He revealed his son in me so that I might preach the revealed son in us. That's what it says. That's what it says. That's exactly what he's talking about. He's not talking about world evangelization as we know it. He's not talking about going to the... He's talking about the gospel, isn't he? He's talking about the grace of God, isn't he? Yes. He's talking about Christ being revealed in him, and that's what that all pertains to, right? Yes. He's talking about, don't pervert this. Yeah. right? And he's talking about preaching the revealed Son in us to the heathen, to the nations. That's what we preach. That's the Christ we preach. We don't preach Christ is now in heaven seated at the right hand of God. He could have said that. Couldn't he? Yes. But he said, we preach Christ in you, the hope of glory. Now I'm back in Colossians. But see, once he saw it, he just kept writing it. I got another letter here, and he's writing them to all these different churches and individuals and stuff, and it's all coming up, not Acts 9, And, it's all coming up, this revealed Christ that is in him, and that the gospel is not Christ revealed in you. The gospel is Christ who is revealed in you. It's different. See, our minds are skewed, and everything's kind of slightly just twisted enough so we miss Jesus, so we don't give him the full glory in the situations. Oh, yeah, I'm all about Jesus, So were the Jews in the sense of all about God, but they missed him. And they didn't just miss him when he was feeding the multitude. They missed him as the Messiah hanging on that cross. All right, so what he's presenting here is not a salvation gospel, but a gospel that is good news. See, we say, well, the gospel is good news, because that's what the word gospel means. The gospel is good news. I'm not going to hell. That's good news. It's good news for me, And now I can see why they call it good news, because it's going to bless me. And God's going to bless me. And he's going to show me what great things he's going to do with me, because I'm a chosen vessel. He didn't even talk about heaven and hell. Isn't that interesting? He just talks about Christ located in him, and that's what he wants to preach. All right, so let's read on. There's a little bit more. Verse 17, neither went I up to Jerusalem to them which were apostles before me, but I went into Arabia and returned again unto Damascus. Then after 3 years I went up to Jerusalem to see Peter and abode with him 15 days. But other of the apostles saw I none, save James, the Lord's brother. Now the things which I write unto you, behold, before God I lie not. Afterwards I came into the regions of Syria and Cilicia, and was unknown by face unto the churches of Judea which were in Christ. But they had heard only that he which persecuted us in time past now preacheth the faith with once he destroyed. See, there it is again. A third mention of the only thing he has retained from the road to Damascus was that he persecuted not just the church. Jesus said, why persecutest thou me? He persecuted Jesus. And that's the way Jesus saw it. And you would see it that way. If somebody came up and they had like some, little tiny scissors, and they coming up and they were just doing like this and just cutting on your body and stuff like that, you'd go, stop doing that to me. You wouldn't go, oh, that's okay, it's just my body. That's the way Jesus feels, except stronger. Except stronger. He feels that. He feels that. See? And so, and then finishing out here, verse 23, but they heard only that he which persecuteth us in time past now preacheth the faith which he once destroyed, in verse 24, and they glorified God in me. So just the last part of verse 22, was unknown by face unto the churches of Judea which were in Christ. See, we don't say, well, I go to the church of da-da-da-da, and it's in him. It's in him. See, this is all, it's in union with Jesus. It's made one by an eternal union now. We are his body, and anything that happens to his body happens to me. See, but we go, we see somebody pinching or using those scissors on the thumb, and we go, get him, that thumb has really been acting up lately. get them, yeah, yeah, they deserve that, instead of going, ow, stop it. Because we're, you know, we're the pinky. We're going, yeah, you smarty, you know. This is off kilter. But I was upstairs the other day, and Mama Cakes, our cat, was on the upstairs balcony thing with me. And she looked up at me, and she meowed in the funniest meow. And for some reason, I thought, she wants to, she's, you know, there's something going on here. She's trying to relate or something like that. And I said to her, if you could ask me one question, what would it be? I know, I'm so weird. I'm even weird to myself. And I would have swore she sent me a thought message that said, why do we not have opposable thumbs like y'all do? Anyway, all right, back to Jesus. I have no clue what that has to do with anything. Except for the pinky says, you're an opposable thumb. That's where it came from. You're an opposable thumb, and you get to, you are effective in everything. You can pick up, you know, this with, you know, well, there we go, and not use me. I don't have to be used all the time. And so we go, so when somebody's pinching it, we go, yeah, get them. Well, that's, how come we don't respond the way our physical body does? How come we don't go, you know, ow, you know? We only go ow when we pinch the pinky. You know, if we're the pinky, we go, ow, then we ow. Over here, it's like, yeah, I can take the pain. Just make sure they feel it. Church is in Christ. And then finally, wow. What time did I start?
An hour or two?
I've been
62 minutes.
Okay, good. This feels good. Last verse. And they glorified God in me. All right, how would we do that? How do we do that today? If someone was persecuting the church and they were wreaking havoc all over the place and they got saved, we would glorify God, wouldn't we? We'd glorify God like this up in heaven. Woo! Glory! Thank you, Lord! But that's not what this says. It says they glorified God in Paul. They didn't glorify God for the work. They didn't say, thank you, Lord, for doing a work in so-and-so. This is all our religious ways. It's not the way they saw. See, the reason why it's different is they saw differently. They were brought into this reality, and it was they preached Messiah crucified. And that's just one aspect of the life of Jesus to us. That's just one part. When to Paul, it was the gospel. This is it. So he, you know, they're going, wow, praise God, thank you for doing a great work in him. Okay, so it's either pointing to God in the wrong direction, or it's pointing at the work and not the God of the work. But the beautiful thing that they said was, that Paul says, and they glorified God in me. They said, that's God in him. That guy's so messed up, that's got to be God. You know, that's God in there. See, and they were glorifying God in Paul. Do you see that? That's different. It's completely different because our views are different. And, you know, our religion has taught us that, you know, you go to church when you first get saved and everybody goes, glory to God, you know. And they said, man, that was God in you. That was Jesus in you. That's the life of another that produced that. We say, well, it was the grace of God. No, it was God. You know, we're attributing all of this stuff constantly. anyway, it's almost like we're working at it, trying to find any way we can just not directly give him the glory. But I'll tell you what, when your heart is set on him, when your heart has turned to the Lord and the veil is rent, because see, like in the tabernacle, before the veil is rent, there's all this stuff that's of God. You remember the setup of the tabernacle. I mean, there was the outer court, and you came in through the thing, and there's the altar, and there's the laver, and then you go into the holy place, and to the right is the table of showbread, and the candlestick to the left, and directly in front of the veil is the altar of incense, and inside of there is the Ark of the Covenant, and the presence of God is resting in there. You can stand outside. You can see all this stuff. Is this of God? Yes. Is that of God? Yes. Is that of God? Yes. Is that of God? Yes. Are you doing stuff for God? Yes. But has the veil been rent? Has your heart turned to him, or is it still just in the ministry? That's the deal. But when the heart turns to the Lord, then it's not heart. They glorified God in me. It's not me. I'm dead. And, you know, guess what? In that same book where he's describing all this, Galatians 1, one chapter over, I am crucified with Christ. Nevertheless, I live, yet not I. Christ, Messiah crucified, lives in me. Lives in me. That's who lives in me. I'm crucified with the Messiah. But the Messiah lives in me. And so then you don't have, there's not this clutter. It's like, you know, I mean, there's some people who are neat freaks and some people who are clutter. I'm a clutter person, but not in my vision and seeing. I can see clutter and I can see past it and I can see that's not the Lord. That might be of God. That might, you know, somebody walking around with the golden candlestick saying, ah, you know, we've got the light. Yes. And, you know, da, 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 da. You're going, have you ever been inside there? No. Has your heart ever turned to the Lord? No. Are you serving God? Yes. See? Golden candlestick. Look. Showbread. I'm of God. But you're confusing everything. Everything has a slight twist to it. Just slight enough and just twisted enough to let it be all about, oh, that was the grace of God. Instead of the grace of God. That was God. You don't even need to call it grace. That was God. They glorified God, and they didn't say, they glorified the grace of God in me. See how skewed we can be? You know, it's just slightly off. It's like if there was an archery target down there, and you had a bow and arrow, and you were far enough away, if you were just slightly off, the further that thing went, the more it would be off from the target. Just slightly off. Well, in this case, the target is Jesus. The one that we want to see is Jesus. The target is that it be about him, that we know him, that we, and see, we don't even have to figure out the scriptures. Oh God, reveal the scriptures. Reveal the abundance of his heart, his mouth spoke. Know his heart. If you knew his heart, then you would know the doctrine that he speaks. But we're still trying to figure out the doctrine. Slightly off, skewed. You see that? Always slight, always just enough off to miss the mark. Him. Yeah, Joseph.
Just thinking you talk about the veil being rent. You know, when it talks about the scripture, it says the veil was rent from the top to the bottom. And then there were ones who came up out of the graves. And in a sense, like sometimes in our minds, we're trying to rent the veil from our perspective. And rent it from the bottom to the top and see Jesus when he's saying, look, this is what I showed Paul was already done, that you were in me before the foundation of the world. It's ripped from the top to the bottom of finished work from his heart.
Right.
And then they said they saw those who came up out of their graves. And that's like the reality of work coming up out of that grave with Christ in resurrection with
Amen.
Him.
Amen. 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 Well, the amazing thing is that veil see, we see that tabernacle and we go, I want to go inside there and I want to be with the Lord. But again, we miss the mark on that because the key in there is out here on a rejected hill called Calvary where he looks like a criminal. And we're like in the tabernacle. And the Lord's going to open this for me. You know what I mean? And somebody says, hey, there's a guy crucified out here, you know, and I think he's the answer. You go, I don't think so. This is the answer. I'm going to stay in here and stay with the Lord into this holy, holy place. Out there on Calvary, that's the holy, holy, holy place. And the depth of that selfless giving and the depth of that heart is the only reason. See, we say, okay, there we go. We say the grace of God. That's why we're saved. That's why we're, that heart, that kind of heart that wanted us with him. I don't know. Can you see the difference between I'm saved by the heart of Jesus because he wanted us compared to I'm saved by the grace of God, which is some sort of religious term that says, well, the grace of God did this and everything's going to be, you know, glorious. Instead of the heart of Jesus did this, and he wanted something out of us. He didn't just want to save us. He wanted to save us and call us by his grace to reveal his son in us. Let's pray. You can, but is that some screaming baby back there?
Sorry.
Okay. Yes.
Try to understand and to respond to the Lord. Now you were mentioning about, you know, there's so much darkness and things in us that we don't even see, that we are not even aware of. But then you are mentioning about turning, mm-hmm. you know, when your heart turns
right.
to the Lord. But it doesn't mean that it's just a one-time event. You know, when I see my flesh. Let's say like this, I see my flesh and it's reacting over something, but in my heart, I see it and then I turn and I said, no, I'm not going to go with my flesh, I'll go with the Lord. And then, the Lord does something in there.
Right.
But it's not, my question is, it's not just because I turned to the Lord at that moment and then, yeah, I got Christ in me or the revelation of Christ or
right.
whatever. It's just like, it's a continuation thing. Am I understanding right?
Well, I think both are true. I think that I think from your the perspective you're bringing is that there is a turning to the Lord, because that's the way you described it. You described it as being led off or dealt with by the enemy or something like that, but then you turn. So there's a turning to the Lord, and that it's a regular ongoing process. I agree with that. But I do think that what Paul is describing there, because he, you know, that little ETH is not a King James thing. It's trying to communicate to us that it is an ongoing process. And there it doesn't say when the heart turneth to the Lord, but turns to the Lord, because it's talking about something that there is a place in time where there is a, I don't, you know, usually, y'all know what I always say. I believe it usually comes out of a really deep crisis. And it's at that point where we are sick to death of us. And then our heart turns and nobody can, you know, because we apply that to these little turnings when it's not that. It is a genuine turning where when we turn because of the just sick and tired of us and the deepest desire for wanting him, then there is a light now the change is ongoing. We're being changed, being, ing, being changed into one glory to the other. But there is, I believe, the little turnings that you're talking about, I believe they're only effectual until the big turning takes place, and that we sort of can refer to that, not just turn and not just some sort of thing within us. It is a remembrance more than a remembrance. It is a as we seek to a reality that we had once when we our heart turned to the Lord, we are yet drawing from that. And I'm not sure if that's the grammatical tense there, but I know that it is in Galatians 2:20 when it says, I am crucified with Christ. I am. And it sounds like in our English that you are somehow, but in truth it is, the Greek is saying, I was crucified with Christ with the present effect that I'm being impacted by that crucifixion right now. Okay, so let's apply that to this thing. Instead of I'm crucified, my heart has turned to the Lord and I'm sick of me and I just want him, that's all that I care about. And I have seen him, but that's a past finished, this is the way it's described, a past finished work having present impact. Okay, so this would be, but I know his heart and I know what he has shown me and I am being changed into that. And it's kind of like we turn back to that light, that reality. That. And when we do, then that floods us again and we're free based on that, not just a present deliverance he's having to do every time. Does that make sense? Good. Good. Sure. Amen. Yeah, I've heard you share what I just shared before. I know that you've seen. But you know, I mean, these are good questions. Anybody else have a question or something? Yes. Or
I looked up the Greek. Got my Greek lesson here on what that exactly is, and it's not a tense issue.
Okay.
It's actually a conditional thing.
Okay.
It's a verb mood, not a tense, and it's a relationship of the action to reality.
Mm-hmm.
And what it means is, if it were so that your heart were to turn, so it may or may not happen. It's not talking about that it did happen, or it will happen, or it is currently happening. It may happen or it may not. It's just because you're saved doesn't mean the heart is ever.
Right.
And that's kind of what it's saying. But if it were to happen, there is an absolute solid result.
Right.
Right. So there's no perfect or present. It's like night in the same universe.
Right.
You know, as far as
what you said there, I think we always call that thing in Galatians 2:20 an eternal verb, meaning that it's always real. And you said that it was at the very beginning when you started speaking, you said it is an action based on reality.
No, it may or may not be real.
Okay, but you, what did you say then at the very beginning?
The perfect tense is based on reality, something actually happened.
Right.
This is, a mood tense is based on the action's relationship to reality. So if it's in the perfect tense, it's in a certain mood that says it actually happened. But this mood that it's in takes it out of the realm of tenses altogether. It's in the realm of possibility, not in the realm of reality, the action happened.
But you're saying we don't have to be tense? That's all I got out of that. That's why I flunked English. Anyway, grammar, literature. Let's stand together. All of the above. Amen. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Anybody feel led to pray? Kelly?
Just can't say thank you enough for opening yourself to us in a way that we could open that door with our hearts and just enter into oneness with all that you are. And we could sit in you, with you, know your heart, not for any other reason, but to know you and to be there for you, to hear you, to fellowship in one, the one you are. There's just so many things that skew our minds, that turn us, that make things that are not important so big. But we want to repent for that right now. We don't want it. There's not so many things. It's just you. It's just you. We just want to ask, not from a point of guilt or sin awareness, but from a heart that loves you. We just want to tell you personally, we're sorry. ourselves not to some deep thing or some thing you do to us. We just want to turn to you. We just want to be with you. We just want to love on you and enter in from our heart. We just want to thank the Holy Spirit for opening you to us in this way. We want to open to the Holy Spirit in a new way to know the heart of God. Not for anything for us, but for Him. Because we love you. We do love you. We want to enter into that beautiful relationship with you, just knowing you. So, Father, we commit ourselves. Commit ourselves, God, unto you. We ask that this would not be a teaching or a preaching or an inspiration, but that our hearts would turn. That our hearts would turn. And this relationship would begin in deeper ways. In Jesus' name.
Amen. Amen. We'll go hug 5 people and you're dismissed.